Western snowy plovers face a lot out here on the coast. From weather to ATVs, crowds, and development, 4-inch tall birds face many difficulties, and they haven't done too well. So when Eric Hall was told his oyster shells could save the plovers, he figured scientists had finally run out of ideas.
I said, what do you want to do that for? This, you know, at the time it was a small amount of shell, you know, a dump truck load or two, and yeah, not a problem, we'll donate that.
Getting Eric to give up this bounty was no small request, since these shells are needed by Eric, an oyster farmer, to prep new oyster beds. But he helped anyway and sent several dump trucks full of shell down the beach toward Washington's Ledbetter Point. With that, the last piece of an unconventional experiment to save a bird was set in motion.
So Western snowy plovers are a small threatened shore bird, and the reason for the decline is that they've lost a lot of nesting habitat. Also, they need open, bare ground that's sparsely vegetated, and so that is what we are recreating here.
Biologist Kirsten Brennan says the dunes along the west coast are disappearing under a carpet of European dune grass.
These invasive exotic grasses are so aggressive that they just outcompete all the other vegetation, and we've lost virtually all of the coastal plant community out here.
The beach grass has gotten so thick that the birds just can't use it anymore.
Faced with this complete loss of plover habitat, the Fish and Wildlife Service launched a counterattack. For the past several winters, while the plovers were away, dozers hit the beach and tore up 40 acres of grass.
You know, when we started this habitat restoration out here, we started with a single acre of beach grass that we cleared, and we got one nest. And each year, as we have been enlarging the area, we've had more and more nesting.
But it was the oyster shells that would turn out to be the key ingredient.
Now we're coming in and we're adding shell back to habitat to make it more attractive to birds. They key in on the shell areas and they seem to prefer them.
The idea behind the shell dumping is that plovers would hide their eggs among the shells as a defense against predators like ravens and crows. But the idea was new and a bit risky, and Kirsten had to wait for the spring nesting season to see if it worked.
We've had a nest here as early as March. June is peak nesting. We'll have broods potentially or nest hatching in July and occasionally into August.
The chicks born on this summer day got a brisk, cold welcome into the world. Even the eagles hunkered down.
Well, today it's a little bit windier than I like to be out here. Up higher, the sun's really starting to blow.
Kirsten looks for new chicks several times a week during nesting season. Conditions like this make that work difficult.
Days like today are not good for much of anything.
But a pair of plovers does come into view just above the high tide line outside the new restoration area. Kirsten drives on, spotting a few more birds along the way. It might not seem that remarkable until you consider how few plovers there are in the entire state of Washington.
There's only 4 known nesting areas in Washington. This is one of the bigger ones. Last year, in 2006, we had about 70 breeding adults here. So that isn't a lot of birds.
At the newly bulldozed recovery area just inland from the beach, Kirsten has documented over 20 new nest sites. She had her proof that the shell project was having its intended effect.
Well, this is a female sitting on a nest. She's on 3 eggs, and we have an exclosure over the nest. We put it on there to help protect the nest from predators, particularly crows, ravens. She's not due to hatch yet, though. She's got a couple more weeks to go.
Kirsten keeps her distance from the notoriously skittish birds.
If they are disturbed frequently, they will abandon the nest. If the disturbance lasts a long time, then that's it.
Human visitors are kept clear of these plovers, but elk are not so easily shooed away.
I came in there one day and they had just trampled around and around and around, and the adults actually abandoned that nest that year. And it was, I think, just because of really prolonged disturbance.
From the air, it's easy to see just how small this piece of plover real estate is. While the cleared restoration area is just 100 acres out of thousands of acres of dune grass, the project has paid dividends, and not just for the birds. Shortly after the dune grass was cleared, a small pink flower bloomed. It was the pink sand verbena, a delicate dune flower once thought to be extinct in Washington.
And it hadn't been seen in this state since 1950. This plant, like so many others that should be out here in this beach community, they're just not here anymore.
Clearing the dune grass isn't a one-time fix, but at least now scientists know that even a small effort can pay off.
You know, when I first came here in 2001, you know, we just saw really abysmal, just really poor nesting success. You know, you get two nests out of 30 hatch, and the rest would get depredated or covered by blowing sand. I think we're starting to see the tide turn.
Great people just doing their thing in their own Northwesty way. We love bringing you stories like this. Support what you love. OPB.org/video.